Okay, great. So this time it is working. It was not working in the last session. So IOP in children, we take the, in adults we don't get the eye examination complete without an IOP, but then why do we accept children without an IOP? Because there are many challenges, level of cooperation of the child, wakefulness, efforts to close the eyes, anesthesia required, and then there are various levels and drugs used, and the use of speculum. They all alter the IOP in children. So whenever we have an patient under anesthesia, the airway is very important. If you use the face mask, it is going to put pressure and in your area, so it is difficult to examine the child. Intubation causes rise in IOP for up to 5 minutes, and laryngeal mask anesthesia is the most preferred way if you are doing a child in anesthesia. Inhalation agents do also affect the IOP, like halothane, sevoflurane, isoflurane. They all cause decrease in IOP by various mechanisms, including suppression of aqueous humor and central system, central control of IOP. Propofol, thiopental are the commonest inducing agents. Propofol is a non-barbiturate and thiopental is a barbiturate, and most studies say that they have no effect on the IOP in case of propofol. And some studies do say that they can have slight decrease in IOP by 40 to 30% in adults. Now, this ketamine is another drug which is commonly used, and we all feel that the ketamine causes rise in IOP. So there are certain studies which say actually there is no rise in IOP with use of ketamine. Some of them do say rise in IOP with ketamine, and one of the studies in fact said that there is a reduction of IOP while using ketamine. Midazolam is another drug which is also used in sedation and anesthesia. It has no effect on IOP, but there are certain studies which claim that there is reduction in IOP when the midazolam is used in children. Neuromuscular blocking agents, if you're talking of succinylcholine, which is a depolarizing agent, it causes an extra ocular muscle contraction and direct effect on the aqueous humor dynamics. This can cause significant rise in IOP. And non-depolarizing agents like rocuronium, atracuronium, they actually cause slight decrease in IOP, rocuronium having the greatest propensity to cause decrease in the IOP. Now, this is a table which summarizes the effect of various drugs used in GA on the IOP, like chloral hydrate has minimal effect. Midazolam, atracurium, rocuronium, propofol, and thiopental have mild to moderate reduction of IOP. Mild reduction of IOP is with oxygen and nitrous oxide. Mild to significant rise in IOP is with halothane, sevoflurane, and isoflurane. Minimal to mild increase in IOP is with ketamine, and marked increase in IOP is by succinylcholine and intubation. So whenever we intubate the patient, it is always recommended that we should wait for more than 5 to 6 minutes and then take the IOP. Now, what are the values? The values also vary from birth to the adulthood. So this is a study which said under the GA, if you use the Perkins tonometer, a child is less than 3 months of age would have IOP of less than 8 millimeters. From 6 to 9 months, the IOP would be less than 12 millimeters. After the 9 months of age, there is an increment of IOP with 1 millimeter of mercury per year till the age of 12 years. And after the 12 years, the IOP range is in the adult range. Now there are various tonometers. All of them have their pros and cons. The commonly used for children are GAT, Perkins, Tonopen, Rebound, and Schwartz, which has a questionable value these days. Goldman Approximation Tonometer is ideal as in case of adults, but it is a little scary. Something would come and touch the eye, would scare the children, but it may still work for older children. Like this is a child around 7 years of age. She's getting an approximation tension done very comfortably. It is not suitable for small kids, and it cannot be done in the supine position. Perkins is ideal, it is best suited, it is reliable, but it has a learning curve and cost involved in it. Also, the availability is a problem because most of the private practitioners may not have this access to this Perkins tonometer. Impact Rebound tonometer does not require a sit lamp and it is less intimidating. It is effective in younger children. You can make the children sit and you can take the pressures very comfortably. It can be used in OPDs as well as operating rooms. It's a small portable device, and people even say that it has been used for the home tonometry readings. Now this is a video which is showing IOP reading under GA, where the patient is in fentanyl, midazolam, and propofol, but this is wrong, because here the speculum is applied to the eye. This will cause false rise in IOP. This is another video which is showing you the correct method of taking the IOP. The patient is under fentanyl, midazolam, propofol, and isoflurane. I don't know why the videos are not working. And this is the Rebound tonometer, where the child is getting himself examined in the OPD. So we can see the child is very comfortably getting the tonometry done. Now there are various studies which compare to Rebound tonometry with Goldman approximation tonometer. This study says there's Rebound tonometer range is a little higher. The IOP measured is a little higher by a factor of 2.3 millimeters. Another study says the it records mean high pressure of 3.1 millimeters, and that another study said the IOP recorded by RBT was about 1.96 millimeters higher than Goldman Applanation tonometer. And this study says that a lot of children, 79% of children, got the IOP checked by rebound tonometer, while 30% of children could get it by the non-contact air puff tonometer. So the air puff tonometer is also difficult in children, and rebound tonometer can be used in these patients. Now, this eye care tonometer now is available even in the supine position. You can make the patient supine, and you can still take the pressures. Tonopen combines the principles of applanation and indentation. It has similar measurements in the normal range of pressures, but it also has a tendency to overestimate the IOP as compared to Goldman's. The tip is a little bulky, and it is again having similar problems and concerns with children as the Goldman applanation tonometer has. Non-contact air puff tonometer does not require topical anesthesia, but air puff can frighten the children, and then they may not even actually open the eyes in the autorefractometer, so that may actually cause a problem to us. Again, the IOP measurements are less reliable. Shiod's has a questionable value. It is not preferred these days, but because there are more better tonometers available, and it is more so less accurate in children because of the decreased scleral rigidity in children. So the principle suggested for doing an examination and anesthesia in children is midazolam can be used for sedation as it does not have a significant rise in the IOP. Inhalationals, agents like sevoflurane and isoflurane are preferred because they reduce a very mild amount of decrease, they cause a relatively mild amount of decrease in the IOP. If intubation is performed, we should wait for at least 6 minutes before the IOP measurements because intubation causes rise in IOP. Applanation tonometer by Perkins is the first choice. If the Perkins is not available, then tonopen and rebound tonometry can be used in patients under anesthesia. And wherever possible, we should use the same device, the same anesthesia protocol, the same drugs, whatever we are using, and the time after the anesthesia which we have taken in the first anesthesia should be repeated so that we can have the similar kind of readings. Speculum should be avoided because it can cause rise in IOP, and IOP measurement should be done before the pachymetry, axial length, and scleral indentation because, again, they can cause fall in the IOP. Thank you for your kind attention.